Between 1864 and 1904, an estimated 62,000 women and men came to Australia to work in shipping and sugar industries. Many were poorly paid and endured harsh working conditions. This is the tragic history that has remained untold for centuries.
Before Australia was a nation, it was a collection of British colonies. By the 1860s, all the colonies, apart from Western Australia, had been granted partial self-government.
Queensland was a self-governing British colony in northeastern Australia. Around that time, there was a white demand for labor.
The term blackbird was another word for slave. Blackbirding was a phenomenon in which Pacific Islanders were deceitfully abducted and held in captivity. They were assigned to work under poor working conditions, where they were laboriously mistreated and were given extraneous work with little to no pay.
This term originated from a practice known as blackbird catching. It was often utilized as a survival method, which later formed this derogatory term for indigenous locals.
For several months between 1862 and 1863, Peruvian ships combed the smaller islands of Polynesia, seeking workers to fill an extreme labor shortage in Peru.
In the 1870s, the blackbirding trade focused on supplying laborers for sugarcane in Queensland.
In the 19th century, Europeans were fairly firmly convinced that they weren't capable of laboring hard in the tropics. They thought they would die, as one source said, from premature rack and decay, so that they were firmly convinced that they needed a coloured labour force. And as those plantations developed, Queensland prospered. Queensland could not have developed as quickly as it did in the 19th century without the use of cheap Melanesian labour. There was no other way that it could have been done.
These labourers were called kanakas, and their recruitment often involved forced removal from their homes.
A Tasmanian whaler, Thomas James McGrath, captain of the Gracian ship, planned on sailing east to the New Zealand coast, where he recruited members to hunt for whales.
He sailed north into the tropical waters. He told his crew that whales were becoming unprofitable because whales were becoming harder and harder to find.
He decided to join the Peruvian slave trade.
Eight of his crew members refused to be a part of slave trade, and so they were dumped on the island of Tutuila.
The Grecian was anchored offshore in the Ata Atoll, located in Tonga, in June 1863.
He yells an invitation to the assembled islanders to come on board to trade goods and treasures. The Atan population of 300 were already used to trading with passing vessels. Nearly 150 Atans paddled the canoes and swam to the Grecian ship. Once on board, they were invited to a feast held below deck. As soon as the Atans descended the stairs, the trapdoors were shut and the ship sailed away with half of Ata's population. After raiding Ata, the crew tried the same tactics that knew at full, where 30 more islanders were enticed into the Grecian's hold.
Some South Sea Islanders went willingly to escape war or social disgrace. Others were kidnapped or tricked into signing contracts that committed them into long-term indentured service.
The majority of Australians, I don't think, are aware that there actually was slavery here. My great-grandfather was not asked politely. He was stolen. I've actually been to the very spot where he's been stolen, where he's stolen from.
These South Sea Islanders were referred to as indentured laborers. Due to this, they were to be treated as separate individuals.
They first arrived in on Queensland on a ship called the Don Juan. Robert Towns was the first to initiate this opportunity and took these indentured laborers to work on his cotton plantation near Brisbane. Towns actively promoted this remedy to the labor shortage in Queensland.
An estimated 15,000 died within the first year of arrival due to European diseases, mistreatment, and malnutrition. The islanders struggled under poor working conditions. Not only was the work extraneously unreasonable, but they received little to no pay at all.
Thousands of South Sea Islanders were brought to Australia to labor on sugarcane and cotton farms. They came from more than 80 islands in the Pacific, where majority were from Vanuatu and the Solomon Islands, along with people from Papua New Guinea, Tuvalu, Kiribati, and Fiji. £5 a year is what they were paid. From 1885, the Queensland government began taking these wages, and the indentured laborers were never paid out.
When all hope seemed lost, a new aspiration was discovered. In 1880, the Pacific Island Laborers' Bill was signed to not only stop the diffusion of deadly diseases amongst workers, but also improve their employment conditions. This initiation led to other forms of alleviation. In 1886, the Pacific Island Laborers' Amendment was passed to hopefully end the introduction of islanders as slaves. It assisted in the scrutinizing of payment and illegal practices of employment. The Pacific Island Laborers Act in 1901 enabled the deportation of most Pacific Islanders in Australia. At the time the bill was passed, 10,000 Pacific Islanders were living in Queensland and northern New South Wales.
In 1994, the Commonwealth government recognized South Sea Islanders as a distinct cultural group and thanked them for their services to Australia's economy. As a result, descendants of the South Sea Islanders were acknowledged and finally seen as equals.
Today's Australian South Sea Islanders have a special place in Queensland's cultural diversity and history.
These establishments abolished the slave trade in the British colonies. It became illegal to carry slaves in British ships. Families, friends, and loved ones gave up their lives for the freedom of our future generation. Without their tragic struggle, nations around the world would have never experienced such triumphant liberations. Other regions, such as Spain and Portugal, followed Australia in this movement to completely abolish slave trade. Although this will never fully justify these inhumane years, it was a leap towards an international change.
Not only did this kindle a local and global movement, but it also altered the way we see our world, the way we see our history, and the way we see each other.